Hello. Some of you I know, some of you I don't. So let me introduce myself. My name is Tim. I am the Spiritual Formation Coordinator here at Booth University College. I think that it's fair to say that this is going to be a year unlike any other. Let's just say it. This year is going to be a bit odd. This year's going to be weird. If you're a returning student, it's weird because it's not like it was. You're not actually returning, among other things, for the main part. And if you're just starting out as far as university education goes, it's going to be weird because it's not like you expected it to be, or maybe were told that it was going to be. So this is just a strange time. This is an unprecedented time. Anybody else tired of unprecedented times yet? I feel a little weary of that phrase, at least. And it's strange enough and strange for enough people that we're starting to use big, scary words for it. And I don't mean words like pandemic. Pandemic is a word that comes from a Greek word that means of all the people or common or public. And we've sort of turned it into this technical term that means a worldwide spread of a new disease. We've sort of domesticated the word pandemic in some ways. No, I mean words like apocalypse. Now, if this whole pandemic experience stirs up some fear in you, you might be thinking, like, Tim, whatever else I needed when I hit play on this, I didn't need someone talking about apocalypse right now. So just stay with me though, because I might not be headed where you think I'm headed with this. When most people think of apocalypse, they think of destruction, right? We think of images of flaming carnage, of a post-apocalyptic ruin, of mushroom clouds under which the earth and everything we care about is melting or something else that's cataclysmic. And there are a few discernible reasons why we tend to associate those kind of images with that word. We might never even think about it. We just do that. But one of the discernible reasons that we associate those kinds of images with apocalypse is because in film, in movies, that's kind of the association that the filmmakers have made. We talk about apocalypse and then we look at those kind of images. Another really big reason, though, is that the biblical book of Revelation used to be called the Apocalypse of John. And I'm guessing maybe you didn't see that one coming. Revelation is a book full of all kinds of symbolic imagery, and lots of it's graphic and violent and destructive. It's basically the working definition of apocalyptic literature of the day. There's lots of examples of this. This one just happens to have made the cut and ended up in the Christian collection that is the Bible. Barely made the cut, by the way. That's a curious story in itself. But it's just got all kinds of crazy stuff in it. It's got slaughter and plague, yes, plague, famine, catastrophe that arrives on the back of dragons. It's got armies that are so numerous they're like the sands of the sea, and horses bridle deep in blood in the city streets. It's pretty gruesome stuff at many points. And in fact, if you look up a definition of Revelation in the Oxford Bible Dictionary, this is what you'll find. You'll find that book described as, quote, "a book about the expectation of an imminent cosmic cataclysm in which God destroys the ruling powers of evil and raises the righteous to life in a messianic kingdom." So there you go. That's pretty apocalyptic. Anyway, in terms of the popular imagination, outside of religious subcultures, you might not hear a lot about the righteous and being raised in the messianic kingdom. In the popular conversation, though, you'll hear plenty about imminent cosmic cataclysm. In fact, that's one of the reasons why that word, a word like apocalypse, stirs up so much fear. The name of the book, in terms of the book in the Bible, that name got changed by John Wycliffe from the Apocalypse of John to Revelation when he did his English translation in the late 1300s. And in terms of what those two words mean, Revelation and Apocalypse, that's a really legitimate change. And we'll get into that in a second. But I think the change itself has something to say to us that's important for what our year at Booth could be like. Now, I'm going to have to unpack that a little bit, I suspect. So let me do that. Well, first of all, big surprise, the word apocalypse comes from two other ancient Greek words. One is apu, and the other is kalupto. Now, apo means away or from or other. Kalupto means to cover or conceal. So the original Greek word apocalypse means to uncover or to reveal or to lay bare. That's kind of interesting. If you look up apocalypse in a contemporary dictionary, you'll find that the word literally means an uncovering, a disclosure or a revelation of knowledge. So Wycliffe's name change for that book, given what the contents of the book were understood to be about, kind of makes sense. Now, here's the thing I want to point us toward today, though. While that sense of referring to some kind of significant upheaval is still there in that definition, the focus is not on the upheaval. The focus is on what's revealed by the upheaval, not the upheaval itself. And it kind of carried with it, this original meaning of the word apocalypse, kind of carried with it this image of stretching your neck to see, like standing on tiptoe to see. In fact, one translation of the Greek is literally to watch with outstretched head. That's what the word apocalypse means. I think it's fair to say that for most of us, and for many, many people around the world, this pandemic is definitely an upheaval. It certainly tossed some aspects of what we're doing together at Booth into disarray. But if we think about that original definition, about the idea that what matters most is not the upheaval, but what's revealed by the upheaval, if we think about these events that we're in the midst of as something that could provoke or prompt us to, you know, stretch our neck, to stand on tiptoe a bit, to consider what an experience like this might help us to see more clearly, might help us to understand better, might help us to move toward change in our own lives or to change in the culture around us, we're still talking about apocalypse, but now we're also talking about something like hope for change. Now maybe we're talking about something that's more like what the psalmist is trying to get at in Psalm 27, at which point the poet has all kinds of trouble in their life. And as Eugene Peterson renders that psalm in The Message, all hell is breaking loose. They've got plenty of upheaval. They've got more than enough apocalyptic experiences to go around. And yet in the middle of that, the psalmist describes the potential experience of being with God as, quote, the only quiet, secure place in a noisy world, a world in which all hell is breaking loose, an apocalyptic world. It's not a denial of upheaval. It's a way of responding to apocalypse by continually seeking to see where the light and the love and the peace of the divine can be found in the midst of it. The psalmist leaves us with these words at the end of that psalm, which I think are also pretty good ones for the beginning of a formative year like the one that we're heading into sharing together. He ends the psalm this way: I'm sure now I'll see God's goodness in the exuberant earth. Stay with God. Take heart. Don't quit. I'll say it again. Stay with God. Looking forward to our year together. Peace, everyone.